it on your phone. She just started.
So what do I do?
You're fine. Just go to your page.
Mm-hmm. Got it.
He's got it.
So what do I do?
Yes, he does. Okay.
Hi, everybody. I promise we're getting our act together here. This is how you know it's live, folks, right here. Hey, everybody, it's Michael Cogdill, Facebook Live, and we are at Fluor Field. It is not the baseball season. It is the season of gratitude, a season of giving, and our drive for Harvest Hope is so very well underway. Look what so many of you have done just since noon today. Folks, this warms my heart and warms it very deeply. So many people, and Harvest Hope will tell you this, rely on this. They go without in these great United States. So many of them, 1 in 5, are children they serve. They serve meals by the hundreds of thousands into the millions each year. And we're going to be here until 6:30, 7 o'clock tonight. I want to meet some of you. This is my public going away. It's not a party. It's a reception. A reception for giving to Harvest Hope here, folks. I have something to show here as well. I just told our promotions director, we're having a fire sale on these. Absolutely, they're trying to get rid of them. So if you want to come by and get one of these and use it for target practice, feel free. I'm okay with that. I would love to meet so many of you today. So many of you have come by already. We are so grateful, so gratified by this outpouring. This is what we've gotten used to at WYFF4. Over the years, I've been here 33 years doing this, folks, telethon after telethon, for 9/11, for Haiti, for tornado victims. So many of you have been so generous to the American Red Cross, and now today you're generous to Harvest Hope Food Bank. It's over there on White Horse Road. Yes, they line up. And here we go with a lineup right now. They line up to get food multiple days a week. Thank you so much, Vidya. You're so kind. Thank you, thank you, thank you. So sweet of you. Let's make sure that lady's tailgate gets down. Again, folks, we are grateful to you. We can't say thank you enough. And we're saying thank you on behalf of so many people who are doing without, who are in food insecurity, as they say, in this business, if you will, of making sure people have enough to eat in this great country. We want to thank the Greenville Drive. I am available for middle relief, and this is the kind of relief we're talking about here. Again, it's not the baseball season, it is the season of giving, and we are so, so grateful. And I am going to say thank you right now. Hi, folks, I'm Michael. Michael Cogdill, we're at Facebook Live right now. Yeah. I appreciate that. You folks are so kind. Thank you so much.
When you're leaving this month?
Tuesday.
This
coming Tuesday.
Yep. Well, good luck.
It's counting down. Wonderful. You are so sweet. And you folks are wonderful to help out.
Well,
thank you so much, you guys.
Good
to see you. Thank you.
You
folks, again, I could not do this without you. And many of you know, and I've got a picture I'm going to show a little bit later on here. This is in memorial to my father. Many of you know my father went hungry in Canton, North Carolina as a child of the Depression. He was so grateful all of his life for a plate of food, the opportunity to work for a plate of food. And he wanted to make sure that children in his own family, me, and any child he could find, didn't go without something to eat, because he knew how it felt as a child to feel that grind of hunger in the depth of his belly. There are children still doing that in this country. We're not in a depression right now. We're not even close. But what we're in is a situation where some people are invisible. They're easy to miss. They show up at Harvest Hope Food Bank day after day after day after day because they need help. And so many of you are providing help. John, I'm going to let you shoot this one more time. I'm going to get a picture of Dad out of the, let's put this picture away and get a picture of Dad out of the attaché. Folks, this is how you know it's live. Here we go. Folks, that's the man right there. I love him so very much. I miss him. He's been gone since 2002. This man was one of the hardest working people I've ever known in my life. And he loved children so, so much because he did not know that love as a child himself. He made sure that I have this career that I've had to been blessed with for these 33 years. He made sure it was there. He made sure the education was there. He made sure that there was food on the table. This man worked so hard. He was a Teamster, Western North Carolina, Consolidated Freightways. He drove those big 18-wheelers and loved every minute of it, even in the cold of those mountains. He worked hard for me. I know so many of you work hard for your resources, and so many of you have shared those resources already today. I don't know how much this weighs, but I wouldn't want to pick it up, and we're just getting started. What time is it? It's just now 2:30. This is about the time I would be getting to work. We're not even going to go on the air until 4 o'clock. Thank you, folks. Thank you so much for everything that you are doing to help us out here, whether you're giving a monetary donation, saying a prayer, or coming by to say hey and drop off some food. We are so, so grateful to you today. What we need is pretty easy. Canned meat, canned soup, canned vegetables, dry pasta, dry beans, mac and cheese, rice. They can use some plastic bags. They can use cereal. Yes, they can use diapers because children need help. Families need help. Single moms need help. This food bank is enormous. And stay tuned up at 4 or 5, and I don't know which just yet, we're going to air a story that photographer Chip Basden and I did. I got photographer John Hendon right here, camera on the shoulder. Chip and I did a piece back in April on the impact of the food bank post-pandemic. We did one in the sort of in the teeth of the pandemic when people were showing up and wrapping around for a mile around the food bank building there, which is enormous. Then we followed up to see what we would find. We found the line a little bit shorter, thank God, but we found the shelves were almost empty because when food started selling again, there's less for the grocery companies to give away, and so Harvest Hope needed help back in April. They need your help now, and so many of you are helping out today. Again, this is a memorial to my dad. My public reception here, I didn't want a party. I wanted to do something for the least among us. This man knew all about that. He was one, worked his way out of it. So many of these poor coming and seeking this food, folks, are the working poor. They have jobs. Many of them lost jobs, were laid off, were furloughed during the pandemic. All of a sudden, there's not enough money to put food on the table, but there was help here. That's who we are as a country. That's certainly who you are as an upstate. Again, you're so, so generous. One of the things that I will always have top of mind, it'll be a mantra of mine. When people ask me about my career, I worked before some of the most generous people on the planet. People who knew how to love out loud, people who knew how to make the invisible visible, how to help them, how to feed them. And that is what you were doing. Thank you very much. Yeah, I appreciate that.
Thank you.
God bless you. Good to see you.
Amen. Always.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes, sir.
And that's the way it's been, folks, since noon today. We had a line at noon. I'm sure we'll have a line again. We won't keep you waiting long, I promise. We're going to do this until 7 o'clock tonight. Folks, it is a beautiful day. It's a good time to come now. Beat the traffic. If you can't, the traffic will give you an opportunity just to feel good about yourself, feel good about what you're doing. We hope you do, because we know you're making a difference. We see it. We cover it. We get our feet on the ground where people are suffering. We've been in the car there at the line at the food bank. Harvest Hope is doing divine work. Here, you see right there on the sign, they do it in the Midlands, the Upstate, the PD. Thank you, folks. Thank you so much. Our gratitude is deep, and we got a line again. John, check it out. It's just so gratifying to see. And here comes my friend Lee Terza with a box in her hand. Hello, my dear. We are up Facebook Live right now. Lee, yeah. Lee.
I didn't know you even remembered my name.
Of course I remember your name. You and I went to California together, for Pete's sake.
Yes, and I've got a thank you letter from
so
me
sweet of you.
And from the Upstate.
You are so kind. So,
your
so sweet.
Professionalism. We will miss that. We will miss your
you are
caring
so kind.
Personality.
So sweet of you.
We will miss all of that, Michael.
I'm not going anywhere, I promise, but you are so sweet. Tell the fine folks at home
why
we went to California. Why we went to California.
Because Michael and Carol and YFF were housed years ago for Children's Miracle Network.
Yes,
telethon.
We were.
for the Children's Hospital, and we raised lots of money. We did lots of good work.
Millions. Millions, yes. Thanks to you. We didn't do it. You guys did
they
it.
They did it.
We just,
did
I did push-ups and went to California with Lee Terza. You were the boss, too. You were the boss.
Told good stories. Told good stories mm-hmm. about the good work going on.
Children
at
getting
the hospital.
Well.
That's right. And how all the people across the upstate could help.
And you were with, when it's now Prisma Health, but the Greenville
right.
Hospital System, the Children's
That's
Hospital,
right.
still doing wonderful work. Thank
That's
you all
right.
for what you did for the Children's Miracle Network over all those years.
That's
we were
right.
so honored.
That's
Lee.
Right. And then Michael came to this sweet little hospital called Cannon Memorial Hospital mm-hmm. in Pickens.
I remember that.
And entertained the auxiliary.
yeah, well, they were easily entertained, clearly. Lee, thank you so much.
You.
Much love to you. Yes. Thank you so much. This is so sweet.
Book.
You're going to get it. Well, the new children's book, consider it done. Thank you, ma'am. Lee, thank you so much. Much love to you. See, that is who this area is, folks. I'm going to open this while we're Facebook Live. Let's see what we got here. A beautiful card from Lee Terza. She was so caring of those children. Yes, a tribute to Western North Carolina there. Thank you so much. This kind of thing reminds me that I was raised in a great part of the world, in the greatest country in the world, by great people. My mom and dad knew about compassion. I'll tell you a story about my mama. Some of you have heard that. Hi, folks. How are you? Good to see you.
Good. How are you?
Good. We are up Facebook Live. We're honored. Thank you so much and so grateful. Great to see you. That's Kelly Hoffman over there, our promotions director. She's been so kind to make sure that everything went well here. That is tremendously generous of you, Maria. Thank you so much. It is great to see you.
It's nice to meet you.
The honor is mine.
Good luck with your future endeavors.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I'm surrounded by greatness in there. There's a gentleman right there with his camera on his shoulder who's part of it.
Well, congratulations to you, too.
I'm getting rid of me. Yeah.
No. Thank you.
It's great to see you guys. Thank you so much. Folks, I'll tell you a story that that I've used in speeches. I got my dad just, you know, on the top of the food bank here. My mother saved up a story until I was in my 40s about a little girl she went to school with, and every day that girl would come to school, and she would have a little bag in her hand, and in the bottom of that bag was a biscuit about that big around, and she was ashamed of it. It was all she had to eat. This is during the Depression, and she was so ashamed of that biscuit and so afraid that somebody would make fun of it that she would go off as far away from the other children as she could get and eat that biscuit by herself. And the shame caused her to hold the bag up over her face. That's how ashamed she was. That's how some of the children had made her feel. But one day there was one other little girl in that schoolhouse who had seen way too much of that and heard way too much of what the other children said. And she got up. She was a popular, tall, pretty girl. And she walked across that schoolyard and she handed one half a sandwich to that little girl. Folks, that was the first time in a long time that little girl who was eating her luncheon out of a bag with her face in the bag, it had been a long time since she had had enough to eat. But for the first time in probably her life, she had a friend. That other little girl who walked across that schoolyard and gave that half a sandwich was my mom. And she saved that up until I was about 42 years old and all of a sudden told that story sitting in our living room in Weaverville, North Carolina. She had kept it just between her and another little girl who needed some help. And I'll never forget, I looked over to my dad. We all had tears in our eyes and he said, "Well, you get behind me, boy." It's the first I've heard tell of it. She wanted to brag about it. My mom was raised by my Aunt Catherine, my Aunt Kitty. My mom went home and told my Aunt Kitty what was going on, that there was a child coming to school, didn't have enough to eat. They were gentlemen farmers. They had plenty there in Western North Carolina. The next day, my Aunt Kitty made sure my mother went to school with two sandwiches. And I don't know how long that went on, but it went on long enough to make sure, at least for a time, for a spell, as they like to say back then, that a little girl who didn't have enough had enough to eat. And my mother's name was Margie. That mother, that woman, that little girl, she gave the sandwich to, her name was Margie as well. Two little girls named Margie united by not just charity, by the love of half a sandwich, the love that is having enough to eat. Folks, you're doing the same thing. In 2021, on this November day, just before Thanksgiving, that's what you were doing, and we are so, so grateful to you. I'll let you in on a little secret. My last day on the air, last night on the air, will be this coming Tuesday. We're going to say a big goodbye. I'm not going anywhere. I'm not dead. I'm just retiring, so they're not going to bury me. But this is for sure. I'm going to leave with immense gratitude to all of you for these 33 years. I'm a homeboy here. I'm a Western North Carolina boy, born and raised in Weaverville, North Carolina. I am going to leave this career, as it just turns out, pure happenstance, on the anniversary of the death of my dad. I do that with immense pride. Immense pride, just so happens, in this man right here. This man is alive inside of me. He truly is, as is my mom. So many of you were so kind to follow along the journey of my mother into her retirement out of Weaverville, into my home. I got to take my mom all over the place. Took her to the Emmy Silver Circle in Atlanta. It's like she'd gone to heaven. I took her to weddings. I took her to dances. I took her to places she wouldn't ordinarily get a chance to go as an older lady. And then, of course, into the depths of dementia, she slowly descended. And all of you were right there. All of you were right there on Facebook, on Instagram, in person, with such empathy, such kindness, with your hand to my back. The spirit of my mom, who's been gone a little over a year now, celebrates all of this. And she celebrates him. They were married 55 years when he died, but there's a little secret between the two of them. My parents were born 4 hours apart. My father was 4 hours younger than my mother. He never let her forget it. You know, your mother is a whole lot older than I am. I don't remember any of that. They had such fun with that. They had such fun together. They overcame so much. This man overcame so much in life. He is proof that the ability to work, the drive to achieve dignity, it will matter. This is not just food here, folks. This is human dignity you were given. Imagine the erasure of dignity that comes in not being able to provide for your family, not being able to provide for children in your life. It's hard for people to show up and ask for help, but gratifying to have the help and to live in a place like this where help comes so abundantly with such extravagance. Folks, do come by. I'm going to be here until 7 o'clock. I'm going to be live on the air starting at 4 o'clock, talking to Jane and Gabby, Carol, Nigel, and my congratulations once again, of course, to Nigel Robertson. He is a dear, dear true friend to me. We've been friends, we've been colleagues all these years. This job is Nigel's to take forward. And I am so happy for him, so happy for his family. Please wrap around him the same arms of love you wrapped around me. He's going to want that. I want that. And Nigel deserves it. Thank you again for this, folks. We'll be here again over these next few hours. Harvest Hope Food Bank, if you need help, and people from the food bank are going to be here, we're going to do some interviews live, as a matter of fact, starting at 4 o'clock. But Harvest Hope Food Bank is on White Horse Road. We have seen the line, and it is long. Still, as we emerge from the pandemic, we have not emerged from people needing help, and you are providing that help. We'll be back soon, folks. Again, it's Michael Cogdill here, Facebook Live at Fluor Field. We're right here at the Will Call windows, right here at the main entrance. This is the third base side, Markley Street. We're easy to find, easy to get to, no traffic problems here at all. But we want to create a bit of a traffic jam. Sorry, Greenville police, starting at 4 o'clock. Not really a traffic jam, just a line right up. I'll be so honored to say hello to you and to say thank you for 33 years of your support and for this as well. Michael Cogdill, Facebook Live at Fluor Field. See you in a bit.